Hello, everyone, and welcome to UBS Trending. I'm Anthony Pastore. The thoughts of the Fed, the impact of the ongoing COVID pandemic, and uncertainty about markets in 2022, all these topics and more, I know, are top of mind for many investors like yourselves. So let's digest some of these today with my guest, Jason Brady, President and CEO of Thornburg Investments. Jason, thank you so much for joining us on Trending. It's really nice to have you back.
That's a huge pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Jason, listen, there is a lot to talk about. And I thought before we get to a lot of these questions, I wanted to start off with the Federal Reserve with you. Last week, the minutes of the December 15th and 16th meeting were released, and we did get a much more hawkish tone from Jay Powell and the Fed than had originally been expected in those minutes. What do you think the Fed has in mind for 2022 as far as this hawkishness that we're really starting to see?
Sure. So it's interesting that the minutes were a market-moving event, and actually the release the after the meeting wasn't so much, even though they were fairly consistent. Actually, this week in congressional testimony, Jay Powell really laid out something that I heard that was very different from what we heard in 2021, which was that the Fed is trying to be forward-looking and proactive. You may recall that the Fed changed its paradigm in the context of saying, hey, we're going to wait until we see the whites of inflation's eyes before we move, and the whole conversation around transitory. Well, as it turns out, transitory was only the case until Jay Powell was renominated. And so now we have a much more proactive Fed. What I'll say is a couple things. One, Bill Dudley, the former New York Fed president, talked about the fact that the Fed is much more likely to move more aggressively than less, and even pointed out that if this were a sort of more typical hiking cycle, the Fed wouldn't be raising three or four times, which is now making news. The Fed actually would be raising something like 25 basis points per meeting, which if started in March would be seven times. So I think investors can expect that the Fed is going to be more forward-looking, less concerned about market prices, and much more concerned about their obvious mandate of inflation and unemployment. One last thing I'll say, though, is I think a lot of this concern is starting to be priced into markets. So we're going to have to look around corners to see not just is the Fed going to raise rates, but what does that mean for markets now?
Yeah. Do you actually think that that's going to be a big driver for markets this year?
I do. I think that it is a driver in the context of volatility. Now, ultimately, where rates settle or where we start to see demand for the long end is an interesting question. I would note that 2018 is maybe an interesting analog for this year. We saw rates start to rise, the Fed be a little bit more aggressive. And then when the economy fell apart and the curve was flattening, you started to see the speed limit for the U.S. economy in the context of rates. Then it was about 3%. My guess today is it's a bit lower. So we'll really look to see what that speed limit is as far as when the rising rate starts to be a real inhibitor for the economy. That said, the Fed really actually needs to inhibit the economy, needs to inhibit animal spirits. The punch bowl has been at the party for way too long.
Right. Thanks, Jason. And obviously, you know, one of the things we saw in the minutes is that the Fed said the economy may not be far from the Fed's maximum employment goal. But here, on the other hand, you still have so much uncertainty around the pandemic, especially with Omicron, which is really taking people away from their jobs because so many people are getting this variant. Not to say that they're leaving the workforce, but it is pulling people out and it's causing, you know, labor shortages, you know, even temporarily. You still have these supply chain issues, et cetera. So when it comes to the pandemic, how do you position with all of the unknowns that are still ahead of us?
Sure. So just to relate it back to the Fed, you know, Fed President Loretta Mester talked about how the economy really has been fairly resilient in successive COVID waves. And I would agree with that. So what you've seen is less and less effect, not just on the economy, but actually on the markets. Now, that said, well, what you really need to see is how you really need to be positioned is a couple of things. One, in the context of a market where lots of folks are over-indexed or over-allocated to large cap U.S. tech, you really want to see, okay, how can I be a little bit more nimble? High quality fixed income can be ballast. I like our multi-strategy fixed income for really both balance and nimbleness. And then really folks need to consider continuing to have balance in their portfolios by allocating outside the United States. You know, a Another bank did an interesting study which said that 90% of large cap U.S. tech moves and pricing can be explained by the 10-year U.S. Treasury. I'm not sure that's where investors want to be in this environment.
Right. And interestingly, you know, when we think about where the markets are going, you can't really not talk about inflation. I mean, it has been really the story of the pandemic for the most part, besides, you know, when it comes to the actual, you know, people getting the virus, et cetera. You look at the flip side of that, and from the market's perspective, it is all about inflation. And you talk about how equities might actually be the best hedge against inflation, but there has been so much volatility in the equity markets. We've been seeing, you look at the S&P 500, it's down for the last few sessions. And on the flip side of that, treasury yields are just soaring yet again. So do you think that this is all overdue? Do you think it's something more fundamental? Do you think inflation is playing a role here in what we're seeing as far as how the markets are trading?
Well, sure. I think volatility is long overdue. You know, we might have been lulled to sleep in the markets over the last couple of years. But one thing I think investors need to think about is as the source of gains, right? So is the source of gains in the equity market from growing earnings, or is the source of gains from PE expansion or multiple expansion? And we want to be in places where the source of gains is earnings. Because ultimately, interestingly enough, in 2021, companies that grew earnings the fastest actually performed the least well. I don't think that's something that's going to be able to continue longer term. So our multi-asset income strategy is one where, by and large, we focus on dividend-paying stocks globally. That tends to be companies that have strong cash flow capabilities, and they're growing that cash flow. Again, quality and growing earnings. Ultimately, then you're not dependent on multiple expansion, in some cases, as I said earlier, driven by the level of very low level of yields.
Terrific. And you still think stocks are the best hedge right now against inflation?
Well, the real challenge is that the 10-year U.S. Treasury is a negative real yield. So you're guaranteed to lose money on a real basis. That's not a great hedge. Now, you can do some very interesting things within fixed income, and I think there's a lot of nimbleness and volatility in that market that can work very well for investors. But absolutely, you see in inflationary environments, in many cases across history and across the globe, that for sure equities, especially quality equities that again are growing cash flow and are able to grow cash flow in the context of rising costs. Those are much better hedges than fixed income. Fixed income, it's called fixed income for a reason. It's fixed.
We forget sometimes that you could break apart those two words and there's actual meaning there, right?
Simple. So, simple stuff.
That's great, Jason. So as we're wrapping up, just for our viewers here, where do you actually see the most optimal investment opportunities in this current environment that we've been talking about for investors who are out there?
Sure. So when we talk to clients, they're really concerned about a few things, right? One is income in a low yield environment. Two is rising taxes, and three is inflation. And we've talked about two of those, the income and the inflation side. On rising taxes, valuations can be challenging in the muni market, but munis are the best hedge against rising taxes. And that's something that has been, you know, a pillar for Thornburg Investment Management over 40 years. So that's one. Two, really, and this sounds like a cliche, but it's very important. Long-term investment time horizon, we're talking about over the next 3 months or six or 12. One element for us of a long-term time horizon is incorporating ESG into actually every single investment we make at Thornburg. That's very consistent with our long-term thought process. And last but not least, really balance in portfolios. I can't emphasize that enough. Again, these are sort of cliche things, but in times of volatility, there's a reason why it's a cliche, right? It's a cliche because generally it's pretty good wisdom. So what I'd say is most investors are over-indexed to large cap U.S. tech. And in this environment, cash flowing businesses really help a lot. Don't slight your equity allocation, but make sure you know what's in it. And from a fixed income perspective, there's so much opportunity out there, especially in a more volatile market. Consider a more nimble strategy. So that's where I really see opportunities in 2022 and, frankly, much further beyond that.
Yeah, terrific. Jason, thank you so much. I know there are a lot of unknown variables, but this very much helps. And I know it's good to get investors, you know, to the table and seeing where your thought process lies. So thanks again for joining us, Jason. Good to see you.
It's a huge pleasure. Thank you so much.
Yeah, we'll have you back soon. And for more information, you can visit ubs.com/views. And of course, if you want to follow us on social media, we're on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, as well as Twitter. And you can also check out some of our past trending UBS trending episodes. They are on demand at our website, ubs.com/studios. And on YouTube. And as always, if you have any questions about your own portfolio, make sure to reach out to your financial advisor. And until next time, I'm Anthony Pastore. Always nice to have you here with us. Have a great day, and remember to keep your eyes on what's trending. We will see you soon.